When I first came, I thought, okay, what I want is a place, a loving environment, a safe environment, an age-appropriate environment for my adult son that was severely handicapped. But what I found out, what I needed was really a place to belong, you know, a place to fit in, a place not for just me, not for just my son, but my husband, my typical children, and then eventually my adult sister with special needs, and then my grandson who has special needs.
Another parent had this to say: everyone needs the support of a church family, including those of us raising a child with special needs who may never live independently and who requires extra medical care and constant supervision. I know in my heart that I have never needed church more than I do right now. To be able to worship each week without worrying about my child has helped me to strengthen my relationship with God so He can help me handle the stress in my life. Our marriage has also been strengthened because of the opportunity to worship together and to have some date nights during the respite events that are offered. Our whole family has the opportunity to grow in our faith. These things are so important. It is so important that I wanted you to hear what a couple of other families said. Make it clear that you were really glad when we came and visited your church. If they don't have accommodations already, tell them what you need, and most will be happy to help you. Help us feel comfortable and ultimately grow closer to Jesus. Another said, when we walk into the building, please don't give our family the deer in the headlights look because you are unsure what to do. Even if you are unsure, hide it, fake it. And we do. Instead, welcome us warmly. Another said, welcome all of us. Attempt to make eye contact with me, my husband, and my children, even the daughter who will not make eye contact with you. This says, I see you. I am glad you're here. And that is so important. I'm going to tell you, I've been in special education for 40 years. There are days that I still tremble when I see some kids walking in, because I just know. I hope I have a lot of energy that day, because they're going to give me a run for my money. Just because we're trained doesn't mean we know everything. I find every day I have more and more to learn. Some days and I probably shouldn't say this in God's house, but I'm going to say it anyway. I don't have any filters. But I'll say, you know what, God, I've learned everything I want to learn. I think I'm good now, but I think I know what the alternative to that is, that that I'll be underground if I stop learning. So some studies say that 80% of couples that have a child with special needs will be divorced. Estimates in some areas is lower, and families that are involved in a church have a higher success rate of keeping their marriages intact. In Mark, we read, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. What does this mean for churches? Whether you are a small, medium, or large congregation, you can minister to people with special needs. I grew up in rural North Carolina, and I mean really, really rural, in a Southern Baptist church. They fully included a young man with Down syndrome into the life of the church. And you guys, this was back in the early 60s, and most people with intellectual and physical disabilities were in institutions. So this is cutting edge for a church to be able to do this. There were no models for special programs, but he was a member of the church and he participated in the programs that were offered. I have visited small churches around the United States doing amazing work, including people with disabilities as acolytes, greeters, ushers, helping with facilities set up, and helping with community outreach programs. Large churches may have more resources, but that doesn't necessarily mean better programs. Planning for a child with special needs becomes much more complex in our larger congregations. Resurrection was a small church of approximately 100 people when Matthew's family came to visit us. Our senior pastor wanted to make sure this family was able to make Resurrection their church home. Let's take a look at what Pastor Hamilton told me this week about Matthew's ministry. So his quote, "Resurrection's Matthew's ministry participants have significantly impacted our congregation. As they worship, grow, and serve as members of our church, we can see the ways that they are used by God to show the fruit of the Spirit. And even more importantly, to grow that fruit in all of us. We are a different and better church because of our members with special needs." Special needs ministry is not easy. They've taught us a lot about the fruit of the Spirit, and they do help us to be a better congregation. The early years were challenging because the congregation didn't know what to do and how to include people with disabilities. And quite honestly, some looked away as we walked through the halls with our friends with special needs. Over the years, with modeling by our leaders, the congregation has learned the joy of worshiping with those with special needs and embracing them. I'd like for you to listen to this next video.
I want to talk to you today about one of my favorite ministries at the Church of the Resurrection, our Matthew's ministry. One of my favorite ministries at the United Methodist Church of the Resurrection is our Matthew's ministry. It started when a little boy came to our congregation 20 years ago who had special needs, and we asked our church, "Are you willing to be the church for this family? Will you love this child and bless his family?" And since then, 250 special needs children, youth, and adults have become a part of our congregation in our Matthew's ministry. And I wanted you to have a chance to hear from the parents of two of these children. Eddie and Michelle have two sons who are now teenagers, 17 years old. When they were born, they were twin boys born with autism. And they found at Church of the Resurrection a church family, a church home. I'd love for you to hear their story. Take a listen.
The boys were born about 2 years after we got married.
Shortly after their second birthday in January, they were diagnosed with autism. And I think for Eddie and I, we handled it very differently.
When you look at the statistics of parents with autistic children, I think at one point they were saying that 80% of parents wound up in divorce that had autistic children.
It is because of faith and friends and family that we are together.
At Mitch's encouragement.
No, let's just be honest. Ultimatum. Ultimatum.
So she said, "You guys need to get back into church."
When Eddie said, "Hey, I found a church," I was like, "Hallelujah."
What made me more comfortable was knowing that there was a program already in place, that there were people there that had experience in dealing with children with special needs while we were here attending church.
For me, that was the first time in a long time that he and I had been on the same page about the boys and about faith and what needed to happen, not only for them, but for us. It has given us an opportunity to be in a place of worship together, and that hasn't happened, and it wouldn't have happened without Church of the Resurrection and Matthew's ministries. God has claimed and called Will and Sean to be his children, regardless if they fit into the norm of what society thinks. So they are who and whose God has made them to be. They are hanging out with people that love them and know that they are fearfully and wonderfully made. And yes, Church of the Resurrection has been the hands, the feet, the heart, the words of Jesus Christ to Will and Sean. I have no doubt in my mind that they know who Christ is. And that is because of the people here at Church of the Resurrection.
I want to encourage you, if your local church doesn't have a ministry for children with special needs, children, youth, or adults with special needs, consider starting one. Consider being the church for people in your community. We have folks who drive from miles and miles away to become a part of this congregation because we have said, we want your children here. We want your teenagers. We want your young adults to be a part of this congregation. Churches that reach out to special needs persons are churches that represent the love of Christ in their community. I want to encourage you to consider starting a special needs ministry in your church.
I hope that you feel in your heart what I feel every time I watch Eddie and Michelle tell their story. I know when I was filming that interview, I could hardly ask them the questions. I was crying so hard. Sean and William were 7 years old when their dad first brought them to us. He had called me on a Friday afternoon and asked if he could bring the boys to church because they had been turned away by so many other churches, including the one his wife served as a youth pastor at. I'm just going to say this again. I'm an idiot. I said, yes, bring them on. Well, we can do it. Bring them. I didn't even ask any questions. I have learned since to ask some questions. But Eddie brought the boys, and he told me that he was angry and he was frustrated and that his wife had given him 1 week. So you heard her say she gave him an ultimatum. She had given him 1 week to find a church home for him and the boys, or she was leaving. So when the boys came that first Sunday, a volunteer and I were standing at the door smiling, but we were scared. The boys were nonverbal, and they were really destructive. I asked Eddie what they liked to do, and he said, well, they like to behead action figures. They like to tear up stuff, and they like to throw things. And I laughed, and I said, yeah, but I mean, what positive things do they like to do? And he said, those are the positive. Oh, God. Please, Jesus, help us. So we wished him well in worship and sent him on his way. I will tell you, it was tough. But each Sunday, we greeted the boys and their dad with a smile and sent him off to worship. Over the years, Sean and William taught us a lot. We learned how to make church successful for them. And I have to tell you, the greatest gift they gave us was when they started having language. And one day, they said, I love you, and blew kisses at us. You guys, I was in tears, couldn't believe it, and then they hit us. So, you know, oh well. The good thing was they loved us and we knew it, and they were just love pets, really. But that doesn't mean because they now have language and some skills that they don't still give us a run for their money. They do. They absolutely do. And they're 19 now. So what you saw was a couple of years old, but they are 19. They're bigger than I am. And they can still take me down on the mat. So, however, I do want you to know that the first thing that they say on Sunday mornings when they recite their daily schedule is church, then Sonic. Their routine is so important to them. But as Eddie has told us many, many times, some days I just didn't feel like going to church. But the boys are going church, church, church. And so we come. And he finds rest. So we go into the world and we preach the gospel to all creation. And by all, that means everyone. That doesn't mean just us who are supposedly typical and able-bodied. Families who are affected by disability may be absent from your faith community because of preconceived ideas of being unwelcome or just because of the great effort that attendance requires. We have some families who have to drive a different route to church each time they come for different activities just so their children will be able to know what they're coming for. because if they come for respite night, they better come a different way, because they get upset because they're going to a different room. We don't even begin to know what these families go through. It's why online church is becoming very popular. We also have those who their kids cannot walk through doors, so they physically have to put them in a wheelchair just to get them into the church building. And it's not just us. They have to do the same thing for school. But we just don't know what these families are having to endure every day. So for us to get over ourselves and give these families an hour or two of respite and a time to worship, it's really not that hard. So on June 3rd, we held the grand opening. Rufus, you need to come and see us again, for our designated Matthews Ministry wing. So you guys, this ministry is 25 years old. This is the first time that we have had designated space for our kids with disabilities. And by kids, we're all somebody's kids, so I mean from infants to older adults. We will celebrate our 25th anniversary this September. This ministry is considered a cornerstone of our church now. And I want you to see, I tried to take a picture so it depicts, we really are on the corner. Due to the growth of the program and the needs of the students that could not be met in the typical environment, the church voted to create this special space. Matthew's ministry as a cornerstone was thoughtfully planned out. As you can see, we have tried to make it as accessible as possible, and hopefully during the next year, even though that looks like a drive up, it's not. It's sidewalks, and we're not supposed to drive on it, but I admit we do sometimes. I break so many rules. I'm not a good rule follower. This is in our, we call it our great room, but it is our large classroom where we have some special sensory equipment for those who need a little more place to decompress or take a break from us. So they can climb in some of those pods and things like that and just be cocooned and surrounded and feel comfort. This is our Sunflower Bakery commercial kitchen, and we have 15 adults with disabilities who work in the Sunflower Bakery. They work 3 days a week, supposedly, baking baked goods, but our demand has increased so much that we are pretty much baking every day. Last year, we baked over 100,000 baked goods. And so today, some of you will have the opportunity to taste a few of those cookies. I ask, and I don't remember which one of you I asked, you, Jerry, how many cookies I should bring. And he said about 12 to 1,500. And so we actually baked that many. And then I got ready to load them up to bring with me, and I thought, oh, dear Lord, I have to reserve a whole airplane to bring all these cookies. So I did bring a few hundred, and the people checking my bags told me that they might not all make it here, but I know there are some out there for break time. And you guys, this bakery was started by a parent who said, it'd be really nice if our students had something to do that they could get back to the church. And we started with a little convection oven. Today, 2 weeks ago, we have this now commercial kitchen that is just for our bakery, and our students love this space. We have about 20 volunteers that come during the course of the week and volunteer in the bakery who would not have otherwise volunteered in our ministry, but they love to bake, or they were retired and had the time and it fit into their schedule. And we are producing some really cool stuff. I kiddingly say, but not really, that we're going to start doing wedding receptions and large group events. And my staff just run screaming in terror when I say that stuff. I am so irreverent, you guys. So this picture I love so very much. It's a mosaic of Jesus, and it's composed of pictures of our participants. One of our volunteers is a photographer, and he comes to our respite events and snaps some incredible pictures. And so he presented this to me to go into our space, and there was a volunteer standing there looking at it, and he said, "I think this picture depicts what I believe, that we are all the body of Christ." This picture is now the focal point of our special needs space. Last year, we had a beautiful stained glass window that was installed. And take a look. So that last pane that was installed in that window was of Matthew. He was the child that our ministry was started for 25 years ago. Matthew passed away in 2005, and although he never spoke a word, he's changing the world still. He's depicted with all of those religious and historical figures. This says to everyone how important special needs ministry is to us. It is the heart of our church. I've had the wonderful opportunity to travel around the world and help other countries develop programs for people with disabilities. And I'm not just talking about in religious communities. I got to go to Russia 2 years ago with a group from the U.S. Embassy. And we were working with universities, hospitals, schools, private organizations, orphanages that were starting to do special education in Russia. All of children are put in institutions, or were, in the Soviet Union until a few years ago. And that year, they were starting public education. What a blessing it was for me to be included in that group. They knew I was from a church, and I got to share our message, not only of what we're doing in our faith communities, but what we're doing in our schools. I do serve as an advocate on a number of organizations in the city, and in my free time, I go and I'll go to meetings with parents to help them to be their voice, because sometimes they don't even know what questions to ask when they go to school meetings or to see specialists. As any of you know who have been dealt with overwhelming circumstances, sometimes you just don't even know what questions to ask. You don't even know what to think. So to have someone to be able to go with you, even if I don't have the right questions, It is a comfort for them, and I can at least take notes and we can talk about it later. So, what are you going to do? There are those in your church families that are affected by disability. You just might not be aware of it. Let's talk about what you can do. What is the need for the individual in your church? Children, youth, or adults, meet with the families or the care providers and ask them how the family members would describe their children's needs best be met in your environment. And granted, each church, it's going to look different. There is no model that works for everyone. When parents were surveyed, they responded with the following: for the entire family to feel loved and included in a culture of acceptance, for their children to learn about God's love, to receive respite, and to learn about resources through support groups. Sunday school for students may be full inclusion, or they may need to have special accommodations. Some students may need additional support for like a volunteer or a buddy who would go with them to Sunday school. I know here at Grace, I was visiting with their staff earlier, and we talked about what I think you guys call friends who go with children with special needs to typical Sunday school. They may also require a special class with volunteers or staff who are trained to work with children who have pretty significant needs. Youth and adults may benefit from a combined model that includes going into worship with the whole congregation. For example, for us, our youth and adults go into the sanctuary for the praise music, and they love a baptism. I don't know whether you guys do baptisms during your worship services, but we do that with the babies. And our students are crazy about babies, and so they really enjoy that. They listen to scripture, and then when the sermon starts, they leave, because a lot of times they would fall asleep during the sermon. But anyway, they go to a classroom and do an adapted Bible study. And for us, that is what we have found to be the best model for our friends to feel included, but also to receive the religious education that they wanted or needed. Again, I said it works for us. We tried a lot of models, and we failed miserably, but we continue to learn. Depending on the needs of your church and community, consider a blend of church-based and community outreach programs. Examples of community-based programs that include everyone, regardless of their beliefs, are respite care programs, support groups, family events, and adult enrichment programs. Our family night out events, which you saw in one of the earlier videos, we hold once a month at two of our campuses. Parents and care providers are given the opportunity to drop their children of whatever age off and siblings up to age 12 for an evening of fun and games and dinner. And we try to plan a theme. The students are paired one-on-one with a volunteer. We do crafts, we do puppet shows. Sometimes we'll bring in a band, but their favorite events are when we do a talent show, which they are the talent and we're the audience, or when we hold a dance. We actually, today is Wednesday. On Saturday, we have a respite event coming up that is our annual talent show. And let me just tell you, sometimes the talent's a little painful, but they're making a joyful noise in God's house. Anyway, it's a great evening, and it's so fun to watch the parents bring their children, and sometimes they look so weary, and when they return 3 hours later, they're smiling, they're holding hands, their whole body just look different. Even if they did nothing but go grocery shopping or whatever, they had that break, and they knew that their children were lovingly cared for by people who wanted to be there. People get babysitters to watch their own children so that they can volunteer at these events. Now, granted, we love for families to come and volunteer, but sometimes if you have little ones, they're more of a distraction than they are a help. Our Sunflower Adult Learning Program is another example of a community outreach program. We started it 5 years ago, and I will tell you, we started it really for our congregation members who had children that were 21 and older and had no place to go. Their public education had ended, and they were staying at home watching TV, and either mom or dad or somebody was having to stay home and be their entertainment and babysitter. And so we presented this model to our leadership, and the one thing that I can say about our leaders, and I think Rufus is similar in this, they've never said no. They just have said, tell us your plan. And God has been good. And we now serve 15 adults a day with disabilities. In the beginning, as I said, it was mainly for those in our congregation, But I will tell you today, at least 50 to 60% of our students enrolled are not members of our church. They are people of all faith. And these families realize that we are faith-based, and we're going to do a daily devotion. And our friends are going to go to staff chapel with us, and they're going to participate in the life of the church. But their families want them there because they know that their family members are going to be well cared for, well loved, and we're going to get so much from them. They are such a blessing to us. This day program, not only do they operate the bakery, but they've formed a little choir with one of our music staff, and they sing frequently at our staff chapels. And let me just say, they're the only ones that ever get a standing ovation. Any of the rest of us that sing, not so much. Other examples of community outreach are special needs scout troops, as I mentioned, choirs, camps, exercise groups. There's a smaller Methodist church in our area that has what they call a drum circle, and they have someone that comes in and teaches them how to play drums, and it's really pretty amazing. And I'm sure if this was a venue where we could shout out ideas, you guys probably would have some really amazing things that you're doing in your faith communities as well. So how do you spread the word about your programs and your needs? For us, we have found that planning a special needs awareness weekend once a year that highlights the ministry and the volunteer needs are our best tool. We have volunteers and students with special needs and their families that serve as greeters, ushers, passing out bulletins, and then our special, what we call ministry moment, is a volunteer and one of our participants with disabilities share their story. Usually the participant with special needs will read scripture, and the volunteer will tell why they serve in that ministry. And I have to tell you, that's the way that we get 90% of our volunteers. Those weekends are so impactful. Especially at times when the whole family comes up and maybe mom or dad share a little bit about their journey. Your congregation needs to hear what these family needs, and I promise you, people will come. You can also go to your youth groups, your women's and men's groups, and offer them up as service opportunities. I know for our small group ministries, they frequently will come together and serve. And that has been a tremendous blessing. Our youth get community service hours when they come and serve. And the cool thing about it is once they come, they keep coming back. I love the middle school kids because they're not as busy, and they got a few more years before they get into all that high school stuff. Get them committed young. Special needs ministry is about building deeper connections and creating genuine and authentic friendships. This is the place where you get to know the people that you serve and the ones you serve with, and they get to know you. Friendship is a gift that the body of Christ must offer because we are created in the image of a relational God. And finally, here are a few resources that I use. Last week when I was at the Summer Institute on Faith, Theology, and Disability, which I was in way over my head, because a lot of these people are big theologians. Anyway, they let me come and they give me grace. I got to hear Tim Shriver, who is the CEO for Special Olympics, which was just like the best speech I've ever heard. But people from Johnny and Friends were there. They have this series called the Irresistible Church Series. And I think now that there are 10 books, the first one was Start With Hello, Introducing Your Church to Special Needs Ministry. They are free. You can download them as a PDF. Then leading a special needs ministry, was written by my friend Amy Fenton Lee. She is a leader in the special needs community. She and I have traveled together and done some speaking. She is not a special educator, but has made herself one. Her dad is actually pastor of a big church in Birmingham, Alabama. But her, what I love about her material, it's so practical. It is everybody can understand it. And she really asks hard questions and makes you think. And she's also my best cheerleader. And then Every Child Welcome, which was written by Katie and Jolene. Jolene is the mom of a young daughter with disabilities. And again, it's scriptural passages, it's prayers, and it's a step-by-step guide. And these are just three of many, many things that are out there for you. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. It's already there. Just ask for help, Google it. There's more information than you can ever begin to imagine. And right here in the great state of Tennessee, you have the wonderful advantage of having Vanderbilt University, which has the Kennedy Center. Eric Carter is on staff there. He's a professor. He is such a wealth of knowledge and information. And I would encourage you, if you have questions, to contact Eric or the Kennedy Center, and they are more than happy to help. I asked Eric last week, I said, hey, your presentation was so good. Can you just send me your whole file and I can just use it for my speech? And he said yes, but I tried to do better. So lastly, I want to leave you with this. Let my soul smile through my heart, and my heart smile through my eyes, that I may scatter rich smiles in sad hearts. I love this so much because our friends make me smile every day. They make my heart happy. And I know that if you experience this wonderful ministry, you'll find that joy too. I want to thank you for allowing me to come here and talk to you about my passion, my love, and I hope that you will find some of that too. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. And we received a number of emails and texts. And I just want to start off with this question. How would you advise a small to medium-sized church, let's say under 250 in attendance, what first steps would you advise them to take to start a special needs ministry?
Okay, so small to medium, and if you're in the 200 range, some places would call that a large church, because I grew up in a church of 50. But where do you start? Okay, what is your need? That's where you start. It doesn't make any sense to start with a children's program if the people with disabilities that are attending your church are youth or adults. So find out what your needs are within your church, and that's where you start. Ask the families. What, as I mentioned so many times in my presentation, your families can tell you what they need to a degree. Sometimes their thoughts are not realistic and you kind of have to do a little trial and error. But start with that. If you do not know that there are any people attending your church with disabilities, then think about what you can do for community outreach. I will tell you, one of the largest programs in our area for kids with disabilities is a respite program that was started by a church that didn't have any individuals with disabilities attending that church, but they wanted to do something. And so they began these respite nights. Hmm. And I want to tell you, it makes me tremble when I go to their respite nights. They will have 300 individuals with disabilities, and then about 200 siblings, which they've now moved the siblings to another church that's a little down the street, and they do it beautifully, and they do it 6 times a year. And they started as a community outreach. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there some general principles you follow to communicate with people of different disabilities?
So I'm not really sure what that question is. Will you read it to me one more time? I'm not sure what you're really asking.
Are there some general principles you follow to communicate with people of different disabilities?
Well, I will say that the people with just physical disabilities don't necessarily want to be paired with or in programs with people with cognitive disabilities. And so I think we have to be really clear about what our programs are offering. I will say that some people, for instance, who intellectually are typical, do come and serve with us even though they may have a physical disability, because they feel like they can share their gifts and they're a little more compassionate than someone who is able-bodied. So, in our advertisement of our programs, it does say a ministry for people with special needs, but to be more intentional, we probably need to say cognitive and physical disabilities. However, in the world today, you have to be really careful with your words so that you're not offending anybody. And this was one of the big conversations we had last week at the conference was, what do we say? So people say, oh, you just don't say anything. Well, okay, then when I say Matthew's ministry, you guys don't know what I'm talking about. I mean, that doesn't mean anything. Labels and diagnoses are given to help us know what we're dealing with. And so I hope I'm answering your question, but we do try to be specific with communicating what we're offering and to whom we are offering it.
So what is one of the biggest challenges that people face in starting special needs ministries?
That is so easy. Your leadership. It's not a problem here, Rufus, I know, because you're on it. And thank God we don't have this problem either. So many churches that I talk with say, how do I get our senior pastor, how do I get our leadership to embrace this ministry? If they don't have the heart for it, you can disagree or agree with me, Rufus, sometimes it's just not going to happen. You have to want to have this. And someone who is not comfortable or doesn't understand or see the need, they're not going to embrace it. Funding is not the issue. I want to just tell you guys, our ministry was never under the church budget until, I want to say, like 10 years ago. So that means for 15 years, the church did not include us in their budget. We received donations, and our Methodist men group did fundraisers every year that gave us funds to pay for our program, including my salary. So you know that I made like 50 cents an hour back in those days. But so money is not the issue. It's getting your leadership and those that have to approve these programs on board for success.
What do you look for in volunteers in special needs ministry?
A servant's heart. You know, I want to tell you, and if you look at any literature, it will say this to you. People who are special educators, who work with children with disabilities during the week, don't necessarily want to do it on the weekends because they're tired. They need a break. They want to serve somewhere else. Thank goodness there are those who do. But I want to tell you about the very best and longest volunteer that we've ever had. She's an attorney. And I swear she missed her calling by not working with people with disabilities. when she is serving with our children, her whole body lights up. Her eyes shine. She's so animated. Other times, you know, she's an attorney. She's not that much fun. So it is really a servant's heart. It is just their desire to be there and their willingness to learn and to show grace.
Do you know of any situations where someone with special needs has flourished in a church leadership role of some capacity?
Well, actually, at the conference last week, I did see she was a rabbi, and she's a rabbi of a synagogue. I think she was from New York, but there were a number of church leaders there who had physical disabilities and several on the autism spectrum. That's about the highest level that I have seen flourishing in the church. I will say that some of our participants have, I don't want to say they've had leadership roles, but they are serving in typical positions in our church. I didn't even tell you guys about this, but we started an employment program this past year, and we now have three staff members. They're regular staff members at our church who have special needs. One has Down syndrome, one has autism, and the other one has several physical and cognitive disabilities, and they serve in our cafe. And to me, they're leaders. They're ministering to us in the cafe.
What are some of the most effective ways that you found to inspire leaders to start a special needs ministry?
Well, okay, look at my face. I'm happy. I think being given to the tools to help them so they see it's not that scary. It's you know, and I say this, and I'm a special educator, I know, but many of my friends around the country who do what I do were not. And if you have the tools, if you don't have to do all the work to figure out how to do it, it makes it so much easier. I know that when I started, gosh, 15 years ago, there weren't a lot of good models. And so I actually found two older women who were in a small church in Leavenworth, Kansas. And by small, I mean like 30 members, and the average age was about 75 to 80. And they'd been doing disability ministry as a community outreach for years. They taught me everything they knew, and they blessed me. And one of them still is my best cheerleader. She sends me messages on Facebook all the time, and it's amazing. But I do talk about my smile. One funny kind of story, but not. When some of our kids need some disciplining, which they do from time to time, I have a habit of saying, look at my face, do I look happy? And they'll go, yes. And my staff says to me, Jennifer, you just don't ever look mad. So my husband fails to agree with that. But I do smile a lot, and it's because my heart is full of joy, and it's because of these amazing people and him that I smile.
Amen. So how could we be praying for you?
Well, I just my prayer would be that help us to continue to minister to our friends around the United States. As Rufus alluded to us earlier, this is a group who are frequently lonely, and they just need friends, and they need to be a part of a community. And just help me and our faith community to continue to inspire others to do this in your churches. We can all do it. We can all change the world a little bit at a time.